Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grand Emporium, Mercantile Monster, The Antebellum South's Love-Hate Affair with New York City, by Ritchie Devon Watson Jr., narrated by Joshua Saxon. 1. That most southern connected of northern cities. On May 13, 1818, Charlestonian Ann Wagner sent a letter to her son Effingham, describing with great enthusiasm her experience as a tourist in the bustling and rapidly growing city of New York. The musical and operatic culture she encountered there ranked particularly high in her estimation. The previous week, for example, she had gone to hear Phillips sing in the play of The Devil's Bridge. His song of fancy sketch, she raved, had exceeded anything I ever heard. Indeed, Wagner judged that she had never seen an opera performed in so great a style since I left England. So enraptured was she by the singing that she assured her son she would attend another performance before the artist left the city. The Charleston matron was as impressed with the variety and price of New York's merchandise as she was with its cultural offerings. The food markets especially delighted her. The meat and fish is beautiful, and the asparagus I am charmed with. I very often go to market and wish I could send you some of the good things. The salmon is the only thing I see high that is 75 cents per pound. Ann Wagner's travels would take her on to Philadelphia, Providence, and Boston, yet the lure of New York City seems to have surpassed that of the other northern towns. By mid-October, long past the time her son had apparently expected her back in Charleston, she remained in Manhattan, slightly but by no means fully contrite for being away from home for more than 5 months. Though she was sorry to think that you have all expected me home before the 1st of September, Wagner wrote in a letter dated October 17, 1818, she went on to observe somewhat archly that it had not been her intent when she left home to return sooner. In response to her son's complaints that she had not written home often enough, she replied, "I am certain I wrote you in Boston and on my return to New York, and in all have written you 5 times since I left home." As much as she disliked being taken to task for being a lax correspondent, she seems to have been even more offended by her son's implication that she had been seduced into extravagance by the mercantile pleasures of Gotham. With barely concealed resentment, she reminded her son that she had properly acknowledged the receipt of both of your remittances, which I am much indebted to you for. I hope it has been all out of funds received from rents, interest, and wages that became due since I left home, as I should be much hurt to think that I had occasion to call upon you. If she gave the family in Charleston too much trouble, she couldn't help it. She was spending her money as profligate southern tourists would do for years to come. She was enjoying the pleasures of a real city, a charming place. Compared to Charleston, she found New York to be a new world. Though she did not realize it, Ann Wagner represented the initiation of what was soon to become a mid-19th century flood of southern visitors to New York. This flood of southerners was in turn facilitated by the flood of southern cotton that was finding its way through the city's port destined for New England and European textile factories. In 1788, 62 bales of cotton had been shipped across the Atlantic. By 1825, thanks to the rapid settlement of the interior South, the expansion of slavery, and the development of Eli Whitney's cotton gin, New York was exporting the astonishingly higher total of 153,757 bales. During the second decade of the 19th century, a decade during which visitors like Wagner began to descend upon the city for both business and pleasure, Gotham was decisively establishing its commercial dominance over its major rivals for the cotton trade: Philadelphia, Boston, and even Charleston. In the period of stability that followed the end of the War of 1812 and the defeat of Napoleon, New York merchants quickly recognized the utility and profitability of loading their ships with the southern cotton Europeans' manufacturers craved and hauling back the manufactured goods that American consumers coveted. By 1820, New York City had, in the words of David Quigley, regularized the movement of capital and supplies between the plantations of the Black Belt and the mill towns of Britain so efficiently that no other American city, North or South, could compete with it more successfully. In 1822, over half of New York's rapidly increasing exports were produced in the South, and cotton comprised 40% of these southern commodities. By 1835, 119 of the 120 ships bound from New York to Liverpool, England, carried raw cotton. The hefty profits derived from the cotton trade allowed the city's merchants to devise increasingly efficient shipping lines both to southern ports, where the cotton was first loaded, and to European ports, where it was finally deposited. Cotton made possible the massive expansion of New York's banks, and the rise of these huge establishments magnified the city's dominance of the lucrative trade. As John Hope Franklin has observed, Southern merchants as well as planters could usually secure better credit terms in New York than they could find in Charleston or New Orleans. Gotham could offer its clients 6 months of credit interest free and another 6 months of credit at low interest rates. Smaller Southern banks with much smaller resources were in no position to compete with their larger New York rivals. Quigley has observed that the years in which New Orleans led Gotham in cotton exports were exceptions that affirmed New York's dominance, as New Orleans traders employed New York ships and relied upon New York banks for credit. Ann Wagner had presciently foreseen in 1818 that Gotham would become the center of what she called a new world, and it was one upon which the antebellum plantation South would find itself increasingly dependent. The process through which Gotham's merchants would come to dominate the lucrative cotton market is strikingly reflected in business history of the Brown family. Family patriarch Alexander Brown was a Scotch-Irish immigrant who by 1800 owned a thriving linen business in Baltimore. But Alexander was an acute enough businessman to look beyond linen and appreciate both the money-making potential of the just-developing and rapidly expanding trade in cotton and the centrality of New York City to that trade. In 1825, he dispatched his son James to Manhattan and his son William to Liverpool with the aim of furthering the interest of Messrs. Williams and James Brown and Company of Liverpool and of affording greater facility and the choice of markets to our Southern friends who are disposed to give us their business. Within a few years, Brown and Company, anchored by siblings in both New York and Liverpool, had established itself among the largest cotton traders in the English market. Brown Brothers achieved its dominance by offering Southern planters a variety of services that could not be matched by local traders. The firm provided planters and factors cash advances on future crops. It arranged shipping to Liverpool and provided insurance on the cotton while in transit. It sold large quantities on commission, and through its local agents in New Orleans, Mobile, Savannah, and Charleston, it offered credit at relatively low interest as well as currency exchange for its clients. By the flush years of the 1830s, Brown Brothers was accruing profits of over $400,000 a year, enough to buy 13 100-foot yachts or 1,300 carriages for Alexander's numerous progeny. In 1838, James Brown could boast of handling 178,000 bales of cotton, 16% of his country's total exports to the United Kingdom. The extraordinary success of Brown Brothers exemplifies the collective entrepreneurial energy of 19th century Gotham's mercantile elite, as well as the phenomenal success of an individual family that would over the coming centuries weave itself intimately into the commercial, cultural, and philanthropic life of New York City. Though the Browns and other New York cotton brokers were businessmen and bankers, the vagaries of the trade not infrequently brought them into direct contact with the institution of slavery. The credit they extended to planters was commonly secured by the future delivery of the slave-cultivated crop, or even by the slaves themselves. When crops failed or planters were otherwise unable to pay back their credit advances to firms such as Brown Brothers, they were forced to surrender what they had advanced as security, their land, and their slaves. Ultimately, the Browns were owners of at least 13 cotton plantations as well as hundreds of slaves, possessions that constituted a significant portion of their wealth. James Brown sat in his New York office, Sven Beckert writes, hiring resident managers for slave plantations. Of course, pious Scotch Presbyterians like the Browns did not boast or advertise the fact that they were among the nation's largest slave owners. Nonetheless, they were nearly as entangled with the institution as a Tidewater or Delta planter aristocrat. Families like the Browns, who through their extensive commercial activities in the cotton trade became intimately involved with the institution of slavery, could feel more comfortable living in New York than they would have been in Boston or Philadelphia. For from its early origins as Dutch New Amsterdam in the mid-17th century through the British colonial period, it had remained much more than its rivals to the north and south, undisputedly a slave city. Indeed, on the eve of the Revolution, only Charleston could boast of containing a larger enslaved population. In the 1740s, approximately 20% of its 10,000 souls were, in the words of Jill Lepore, the souls of black folk. Early English visitors to New York, like William Strickland, often expressed surprise to find a place whose external appearance, though much smaller than London, bore a remarkable resemblance to the British capital. He noted that the dwellings were in the style we are accustomed to. Within doors, the furniture is all English or made after English fashions. the mode of living is the same. There was, however, one clear and inescapable difference that in the eyes of this traveler separated Old World London from New World New York: the greater number of the blacks. Thus, slaves were from the beginning of its founding a significant and integral part of the economic and social fabric of colonial and federal New York City, and as in the southern colonies, their presence became an increasingly troubling element in the consciousness of the town's free citizens. Indeed, racial trouble arrived early in Gotham's history. On the morning of April 6, 1712, some 24 male and female slaves, having armed themselves with guns, axes, clubs, and knives, set fire to a building and attacked whites who arrived to fight the fire, killing 9 and wounding 7. The rebellious slaves, being a relatively small group, were quickly subdued. Ultimately, 21 were executed in ways that would have seemed appropriate to fearful and vengeful white citizens. Some were burned at the stake, write Leslie and Michelle Alexander, while others were hanged or had their necks snapped. One rebel was strapped to a large stone wheel, each of his bones broken with a wooden mallet. With the imposition of these hideous punishments, New York's first slave insurrection ended with the draconian assertion of white authority. It did, however, predictably generate legislation that sought to maintain white control over New York's potentially restive blacks. After 1712, the colonial government enacted a series of laws that discouraged masters from freeing slaves and prohibited free blacks from owning land. Other laws lengthened curfew for the enslaved and imposed further restrictions on blacks walking the streets at night. For example, no slave over the age of 14 could be abroad after sunset without carrying a lantern to establish his or her identity. Violators incurred the punishment of 39 lashes. Such draconian laws, however, were not entirely successful in extinguishing the threat of black insurrection in Manhattan. In 1741, the city was the setting for a second, even more infamous slave insurrection. In New York Burning, Jill Lepore has unearthed and vividly describes weeks of terror during which 10 fires blazed across the city, and 200 slaves were suspected of conspiring to burn every building and murder every white. The punishments administered to the participants of this second uprising were more numerous and just as gruesome as those that had been meted out in 1712. 30 suspects were convicted before the colony's Supreme Court. Of these unfortunate miscreants, 13 black men were burned at the stake, and 17 were hanged, two of their dead bodies chained to posts not far from the Negroes' burial ground, left to bloat and rot. Among Britain's North American cities, New York bears the dubious distinction of being the setting for two bloody slave uprisings. As notable and shocking as these northern racial insurrections may appear today, both were promptly buried by 18th century New Yorkers, along with the corpses of the rebels, and practically expunged from the city's collective memory and its recorded history. Their recent unearthing by Lepore and historians of the 1619 Project provide vivid support for the project's creator, Nicole Hannah-Jones, when she observes that the vision of the past that she absorbed as a black Iowa teenager from high school textbooks, television, and the local history museum depicted a world where black people did not exist. The history of New York City, as it was written well into the 20th century, reflected white America's historical amnesia concerning black America. By the early 19th century, slavery, although very much in evidence in New York City, maintained a progressively lower profile in the rapidly growing metropolis than it had commanded during the colonial period. However, beginning around 1820, the booming market for cotton became a major element in assuring Gotham's continued prosperity, and the lucrative cotton trade thus had the ironic effect of reinforcing slavery's centrality to the city's commercial fortunes. The Brown family's direct solicitation of Southern friends disposed to doing business with their firm furnishes concrete evidence of the way the burgeoning demand for raw cotton cemented increasingly strong economic and cultural ties between New York City's wealthy businessmen and bankers and the plantation South in the first half of the 19th century. From the 1820s through the 1850s, the region's merchants and planters, often with their wives and their enslaved in tow, flocked to New York, to what John Hope Franklin has characterized as the hub of trade between the North and South, as well as other parts of the country, and indeed, the world. Ira Berlin and Leslie Harris observe that these Southern visitors would attend to business, seek the latest fashions, and marvel at the great metropolis. It was only natural that their business partners entertained them in their homes, sharing fine wines, sumptuous meals, and perhaps a good cigar. Together they attended New York's theater, took the waters at New York's spas, and cheered the horses at New York's tracks. Such social intimacy in the family connections that not infrequently emerged from it literally made New York an outpost of Southern culture. Even though the extensive interregional social contacts occasioned by the highly profitable trade in cotton were largely felicitous for both parties in the decades of the 1820s and 1830s, by the 1840s and 1850s, these relations had become more fraught with hostile and ambivalent feelings, especially on the part of Southerners. As sectional tensions deepened over the institution of chattel slavery upon which the lucrative cotton trade was established, Southern planters became more and more critical of what they considered New York's tepid and inadequate support for the peculiar institution that made the hundreds of thousands of cotton bales possible. At the same time, they could not ignore the reality that they remained dependent on Gotham's merchants to guarantee for their region its most regular form of interregional connection in the years leading to the Civil War. Like it or not, and often neither Southerners nor New Yorkers did like it, Gotham's economic primacy would make the city a crucial hinge of union, attaching North to South despite the strain of increasingly heavy political pressures exerted by abolitionist forces. The strong links between New York's merchants and bankers and the South's planter elite had an inevitable effect on the city's culture and politics, assuring that Gotham would remain largely sympathetic to Southern economic interests and generally supportive of the slave system upon which the region's plantation economy rested. Though Southern journalist James DeBow might have been exaggerating somewhat when he opined that Manhattan's economic fortunes were almost as dependent on Southern slavery as Charleston itself, few would have disputed the reality that by 1830, Gotham far surpassed both Boston and Philadelphia in its dependence on its trade with the South. It was thus hardly surprising that by 1835, as Philip Foner has demonstrated, Gotham's commercial establishment had come overwhelmingly to believe that the agitation of the slave question and the interference with the right of Southern slaveholders to own their chattel was inexpedient, unjust, and pregnant with evils. They also had concluded that the dissolution of the Union over the issue of emancipation would lead to disruption of the cotton trade and economic catastrophe. Preservation of New York's economic dominance, they believed, was dependent upon the preservation of the Union, and in the decades preceding the Civil War, no group was more diligent than Gotham's commercial elite in urging sectional comity, even if that comity required that the North tolerate the South's peculiar institution. The willingness of New York's business community to abide slavery in the interests of order and commercial prosperity at least partly explains the glacially slow evolution of the anti-slavery movement in New York, city, and state, during the 80-year period between national independence and the Civil War. Even before the flourishing of the 19th century cotton trade with the South, Gotham had been distinguished from its rivals, Boston and Philadelphia, by the robust presence of slavery in its economic life. During periods of both the 17th and 18th centuries, it had been home to what Berlin terms the largest urban slave population in mainland North America, with more slaves than any other city on the continent. Slaves had constituted as much as a quarter of colonial New York's labor force, a reliance that modern New Yorkers, in yet another deft display of historical amnesia, have chosen to ignore. And if slavery was a significant part of the culture and economic life of Manhattan, it was even more in evidence across the East River in Brooklyn and the other Dutch-dominated farming communities that made up Kings County on Long Island. Slavery may have declined after the Revolutionary War in most northern cities for economic, religious, and philosophical reasons and in response to African-American protest, but this decline was hard to detect in the greater New York City area. In 1790, more than half of Brooklyn's residents were slaveholders, and outside Brooklyn, the percentage of households owning slaves in 1800 ranged between 70 and 80%. In light of New York's 17th and 18th century dependence on and toleration of slavery and of its 19th century dependence on the Southern cotton trade, it is hardly surprising that the process of emancipating its enslaved required more than half a century of strenuous political effort and was accomplished only through a series of incremental and much-debated legislative measures, suggesting both the degree to which New York was beholden to slavery and the limited influence of anti-slavery sentiment in the city. Even as black New Yorkers moved slowly toward freedom, they faced vicious popular prejudice, both from those supporting slavery and those opposed to it. Though the state of New York finally moved to abolish slavery in 1817, the law stipulated that slaves born before July 4, 1799, would not be free until July 4, 1827. Even on that date, children born to enslaved mothers on the eve of July 4, 1827, would remain legally apprenticed to their white masters until they were 21. Thus, some black New Yorkers remained without their freedom until 1848. Of all the northern states, the only one to outlast New York in the preservation of slavery was New Jersey. As New York City slowly disentangled itself from the institution of slavery through the early and mid-decades of the 19th century, it remained a relatively hostile place for its black residents compared to Philadelphia and Boston. The antagonism was particularly virulent toward those thought to be runaways. Indeed, as Jonathan Wells has noted, the municipal police force made no effort to conceal the fact that it willingly collected reward money for returning runaways, essentially serving as a patrol force for Southern masters. Black New Yorker David Ruggles, a prominent participant in Gotham's Underground Railroad, ironically declared the police and other citizens dedicated to catching runaways to be members of the New York Kidnapping Club. Wells describes this loose organization as a powerful and far-reaching collection of police officers, political authorities, judges, lawyers, and slave traders who terrorized the city's black residents throughout the early 19th century. These zealous kidnappers, he charges, were cheered on by a Wall Street business community who supported the capturing and return of fugitives so that peace with the slave South remained intact. New York's reputation as an urban center dominated by Southern sympathizers and defenders of the region's peculiar institution was buttressed by the fact that during the first half of the 19th century, Gotham was not only the plantation South's major commercial partner, the city was also the epicenter of the nation's illegal slave trade, profitably conveying thousands of enchained Africans to North and South America right up to the Civil War. From 1800 to 1860, New York built more slave ships and sent out more slave expeditions than any other port in the United States. The illegal enterprise was immensely profitable. Ron Sedalter has observed that, with the sale of an average cargo of 800 slaves bringing in as much as $960,000, a sum equaling tens of millions in today's currency, many a New York shipowner, investor, and captain grew wealthy from the proceeds of a single successful voyage. The protracted death of slavery in New York and the city's well-earned reputation for supporting and even helping to sustain the system of chattel slavery were reflections of the unique economic bonding between Gotham and the antebellum South's planter elite through the first half of the 19th century. It was an economic and cultural attachment that made Gotham much more sympathetic to Southern interests than either Boston to the north or Philadelphia to the south, and it was politically confirmed and cemented by the ascendancy of the Democratic Party to dominance both in the South and in Manhattan. David Quigley points out that leading New York Democrats of the pre-war period, from Fernando Wood and John O'Sullivan to August Belmont and Samuel Tilden, consistently and unapologetically arose year after year to slavery's defense and unhesitatingly denounced abolitionists. These party leaders organized the Democratic Vigilance Committee in 1859 to help assure increasingly restive and alarmed slave owners that Gotham remained predominantly and reliably pro-Southern in spirit and in politics. On the eve of Lincoln's inauguration, Mayor Fernando Wood urged New Yorkers to respond to the secession of the slave states by declaring its own independence. During the Civil War, these prominent members of the city's political leadership became known and were widely condemned as copperheads, politicians who opposed the war and advocated a negotiated settlement with the Confederacy. Even after the Civil War, Gotham continued to boast politicians like Samuel Tilden, who, serving as governor of the state of New York, continued to sympathize publicly with the plight of the defeated and subjugated white South. His failed 1876 presidential campaign attracted its most passionate support in South Carolina and elsewhere in the former Confederacy. The gradual disengagement of New York City's politically dominant commercial elite from Northern slave labor did not fundamentally alter its commitment to the preservation of slave labor in the South and the preservation of the commercial union between Gotham merchants and Southern planters. One of these merchants explained their position succinctly and rather eloquently to one of Manhattan's most prominent abolitionists, Samuel J. May. "Mr. May, we are not such fools as not to know that slavery is a great evil, a great wrong, but a great portion of the property of the Southerners is invested under its sanction, and the business of the North as well as of the South has become adjusted to it. There are millions upon millions of dollars due from Southerners to the merchants and mechanics alone, the payment of which would be jeopardized by any rupture between the North and the South. We cannot afford, sir, to let you and your associates endeavor to overthrow slavery. It is not a matter of principles with us. It is a matter of business necessity. We mean, sir, to put you abolitionists down by fair means if we can, by foul means if we must. By the early 1830s, Southerners were flocking to New York City in ever larger numbers, and many of them would subsequently agree with early tourist Ann Wagner that it was indeed an impressive place to see. Even a confirmed frontiersman like Davy Crockett was moved after a visit to hail the metropolis as the London of America, the Big Prairie of the North, the Mississippi of commerce. But well before the rise of a strong abolitionist movement and before emotional debates over the issue of slavery created unbridgeable sectional divisions, Southerners had begun to nurture deeply ambivalent attitudes toward the place upon which so much of their prosperity had come to depend. Along with a delight and wonder, there coexisted a strong and growing hostility to what the South recognized as the growing wealth and power of Gotham and the subsequent servitude of Southerners to its economic hegemony. Beginning in the late 1830s, a series of Southern commercial conventions gave formal expression to this antipathy. As one delegate complained, the South stood before New York in the attitude of feeding from her own bosom a vast population of merchants, shipowners, capitalists, and others, who, without the claim of her progeny, drink up the lifeblood of her trade. If some Southerners were inclined to view the cosmopolis as a place of marvels and wonder, others condemned it as a vampire-like beast or even as the commercial equivalent of the whore of Babylon. The New Orleans Crescent urged its readers to stay away from a cesspool of exorbitant profits, reckless character, and speculation, unflinching fraud, and downright robbery. Southern resentment toward what it perceived as its economic submission to New York City extended to a resentment of the South's cultural and literary subservience to Gotham. Though generally not as intemperate as those who denounced the Manhattan's economic suzerainty, many Southerners shared the vexation of Virginian James Heath over their region's subordination to its literary and publishing power. "I wish," Heath complained, "we had energy, capital, and enterprise enough in the metropolis of the Old Dominion, Richmond, and in the Old Dominion herself to creep out of the vassalage that we are placed in to New York literature." Heath's sense of the Old Dominion's cultural vassalage to Gotham was not simply an expression of sectional paranoia. John Hope Franklin has convincingly argued that in publishing, as in cotton trading, there was no real competition between New York and smaller Southern publishing centers such as Richmond, Charleston, and New Orleans. Southern presses were so few and so primitive in their operation that they could scarcely handle any large or complex printing orders. Prominent Southern writers sent their manuscripts to the North for publication, most frequently to Manhattan publishing houses. The History of the Crescent City's DuBose Review, one of the most influential monthly magazines in the antebellum South, demonstrates the cultural subjection to New York that Heath so resented and deplored. Among Southern journalists, no one argued more passionately against the South's economic and cultural subservience to Gotham than its publisher, James DuBose. In one of his many columns dedicated to this subject, he began his attack, like Heath had done with his Virginia readers, by taking his fellow Southerners to task for their cultural lethargy and their failure to demonstrate to the fullest the high and liberal spirit of enterprise. This fatal deficiency had condemned the region to a dependence on New York enterprise, a dependence that had resulted in Gotham's ships transporting most of the South's cotton to market. It had brought millions upon millions of dollars into the coffers of Manhattan's merchant elite. Wealth that might have been employed to advance the region's development had instead been diverted to New York and lost to the South. In cultural as well as commercial exchanges, DuBose argued the South had allowed itself to be impoverished by the same lazy reliance. Southerners had sent their books to New York to be published, and they had visited the city and attended its concerts and theaters. But how many New Yorkers, DuBose asked bitterly, had bothered to read a book published in the South, to attend a Southern college, or to visit a Southern spa? How many had invested a portion of their accumulated years of profits from Southern cotton on Southern improvements? Reading James DuBose's editorial, one could hardly imagine that he would ever have allowed himself to descend into a relation of dependency with Gotham that he so deplored in his fellow Southerners. But it was exactly this kind of dependency to which he seems to have been forced to submit during the years he edited and published his review. In printing his magazine in New Orleans, DuBose struggled during the journal's early years with local printers and their unreliable presses, going so far as to purchase an expensive machine on one of his visits to Manhattan. He apparently rationalized his purchase of a Northern machine with the consolation that at least his Southern magazine would be written and printed by Southern hands. Alas, Southern workmen were unable to efficiently operate his Northern equipment. Ultimately, DeBow chose to print in New York City the review that he wrote and edited in New Orleans. Perhaps even more galling to DeBow was the fact that advertisements placed by Manhattan firms supplied his magazine with most of its revenue. As David Quigley ironically observes, this apostle of regional independence was forced to follow in his enterprise the same New Orleans-New York circuit followed by Southern cotton. Conservative New Yorkers and Wall Street financiers were certainly not unaware of the verbal strikes lobbed their way by publications such as New Orleans Crescent and DeBow's Review. In response, they tended either to ignore or to accept with a degree of complacence the less intemperate Southern complaints about their city. And they remained generally supportive of the South and of its peculiar institution right up to the brink of the Civil War. But despite New York's broad accommodation to Southern interests and opinion, it could never muster the sort of unqualified and unanimous support that Southerners would demand of it with increasing stridency through the 1840s and 1850s. New York simply was not fashioned and never could be fashioned along the economic, political, social, and cultural lines of Charleston or New Orleans. French aristocrat, abolitionist, and mid-19th century visitor to the city, Agenor de Gasparin, astutely recognized the unique political and cultural dynamic that, despite Gotham's marked pro-Southern proclivities, sharply distinguished it from towns below the Mason-Dixon line. He understood the interests of this great city are bound up to such a degree with those of the Cotton States that, until very lately, New York might have been considered as a prolongation of the South. And he was accordingly not greatly shocked to attend a local Presbyterian church in which the minister declared to a sympathetic congregation that slavery deserved to prevail until the return of Jesus Christ. Such cottony theology was to be expected in a metropolis knit by close economic ties to the plantation. But Gasparin also recognized that this theological conservatism expressed only one aspect of the city's complex religious and political temperament. If one walked down the street from the pro-slavery Presbyterian church, for example, one entered a congregational church that protested slavery with holy zeal, as fervently as the Presbyterians up the street defended it. New York City's heterodox political atmosphere was recognized not only by European observers like Gasparin, but also by some who, though born in the South, immigrated to and became citizens of Gotham. One such immigrant was Abram Dittenhofer, a native Charlestonian who moved to Gotham with his democratic pro-slavery parents as a youth. His subsequent education at Columbia and his pursuit of a law career gradually turned him into both a Republican and a fervent supporter of Abraham Lincoln. In his own words, New York transformed him from a loyal Southerner into a Southerner with Northern principles, a man who lived ironically in a Northern city in which resided many Northern men with Southern principles. Dittenhofer sensed not long after moving to New York that it was virtually an annex of the South, whose pro-South orientation could be explained by New York merchants having extensive and very profitable business relations with the merchants south of the Mason and Dixon line. He was also acutely aware that Gotham's merchants generally had for sale on their shelves their principles, together with their merchandise. From his perspective, Abram Dittenhofer could observe, like Gasparin, the complex mingling of abolition and pro-slavery sentiments that characterized Gotham's culture. New York was a place where one could attend and hear a Boston-bred and Harvard-educated Wendell Phillips deliver a radical and brilliant anti-slavery speech at the Old Tabernacle situated in Broadway below Canal Street. Indeed, that great venue for abolitionist speakers would be filled, but most of the audience on this occasion would be, in Dittenhofer's words, pro-slavery shouters who rotten-egged Phillips during his address. With some friends, I was present and witnessed this performance. And yet, as heartened as Southerners might be by New York's rough treatment of this emissary of New England abolitionism, they could never be entirely sure of the sympathies of Gotham's citizens. For Dittenhofer, the confused condition of things in this pro-slavery city was aptly illustrated by the following amusing incident. A Southern buyer had placed a large order for combs with a Manhattan dealer in brushes and toilet articles. Not knowing that the dealer was a Quaker, the buyer had conditioned the purchase on the merchant's exerting all his influence in favor of the South. In response, the Quaker merchant had coolly replied that the South would have to go lousy for a long time before he would sell his combs to them under any such conditions. The heterodox social and political climate that both Gasparin and Dittenhofer observed in this rapidly growing and cosmopolitan American city was reflected in the variety of political opinions expressed in its journals and newspapers, a variety consonant with Manhattan's newfound role as the nation's information center. If newspapers like James Gordon Bennett's New York Herald and William Cullen Bryant's Evening Post appealed to readers sympathetic to Southern interests and to the region's peculiar institution, other city papers like Horace Greeley's New York Tribune and the New York Times raised powerful and eloquent anti-slave voices. In a city where Bennett's Southern-inflected Herald reigned as the nation's most profitable daily newspaper, Greeley's abolitionist Tribune ran a very close second, and its weekly edition was generally acknowledged to be the most widely distributed journal in America. It was just this quality of cultural and political heterodoxy that would continually disappoint and ultimately enrage Southerners as they demanded New York's unconditional allegiance on the increasingly vexing issue of fugitive slaves. On one hand, the business and political establishment of the city strenuously sought to support and enforce the Fugitive Slave Act when it was included as a key part of the Compromise of 1850, and they demonstrated their backing of the South and their commitment to the Union by organizing the Union Safety Committee. The membership of this organization read like a who's who of Gotham society and included names like William Astor, son of John Jacob Astor, and the Brown brothers, who gave the largest single contribution to the committee's budget. As Eric Foner has pointed out, only a handful of Gotham's tycoons refused to join. Yet those few but prominent holdouts included William Tappan, wealthy merchant and the city's most prominent abolitionist, and John Jay, grandson of the nation's first Chief Justice and one of a small number of lawyers willing to defend fugitive slaves in court. At the same time as the Safety Committee was calling for full enforcement of the law and city police were zealously tracking down runaways, adopted New Yorker Sidney Howard Gay was actively ushering fugitive slaves through the city to safer refuges further north. Indeed, his record of fugitives compiled in 1855 and 1856 shows that he sent well over 200 slaves onto freedom. Gay was one of a small but highly effective group of abolitionists who through the New York Vigilance Committee moved 3,000 to 4,000 slaves through the city north between 1835, the year of the committee's founding, and 1860. He would eventually be hired as a writer for Greeley's New York Tribune. Notwithstanding their relatively small numbers, Greeley, Gay, Arthur, and Lewis Tappan, William Astor, and other committed New York abolitionists successfully worked to ensure that by the 1850s, Gotham, along with Philadelphia, would function as the central stations of that glorious humanitarian institution of modern times, the Underground Railroad. Despite the diligent efforts of Gotham's banking and merchant elite to demonstrate their loyalty to the South's increasingly irate and beleaguered planters by endorsing full enforcement of the Fugitive Slave Act, the case of escaped slave James Hamlet vividly illustrates how impossible it would prove to be for New Yorkers to achieve the broad consensus on the issue of runaway slaves that Southerners demanded of them. Hamlet had fled Maryland with his family and resided in the city for 2 years. Discovering his whereabouts, his owner had waited for the new law to go into effect before having him seized on September 26, 1850, 8 days after President Fillmore had signed the act. By the evening of the 26th, a speedy hearing before a U.S. commissioner in which Hamlet had not been allowed to testify had ended with his being quickly escorted in handcuffs to a waiting steamboat. By September 27th, when Hamlet's family learned of his seizure, he lay in a Baltimore prison. The response of New Yorkers to the railroading of Hamlet out of the city was immediate and indignant, and it extended across racial lines. Hearing that Hamlet's owner would allow him to purchase his freedom for $800, 2,000 African Americans with a slight and invisible sprinkling of white abolitionists filled the Methodist Episcopal Zion Church to make contributions toward purchasing his freedom. Even more remarkably, the Journal of Commerce, Gotham's staunchly pro-Southern apologist for slavery, began its own fundraising campaign. The money was quickly procured, and John H. Woodgate, a respectable Wall Street businessman, carried it to Baltimore. Exactly 1 week after his arrest, James Hamlet had returned to his family in New York, a free man. The same city that had turned a blind eye to the building and outfitting of slave vessels had collectively, black and white citizens, organized to purchase the freedom of a black slave. A solid majority of New Yorkers were no doubt content to support the South's peculiar institution if it remained decently contained below the Mason-Dixon line. But on the matter of seizing a runaway like Hamlet, a gainfully employed family man and peremptorily returning him to slavery, Gotham's citizens were decidedly more ambivalent and divided in their opinions. Despite the ministrations of their merchant elite on behalf of the South, the city's complex political and social culture made it impossible for Gotham's conservative political establishment to marshal the kind of unqualified popular support for slavery that the South demanded of it. As New York continued to grow at an astonishing rate during the 1840s and 1850s into a large and increasingly cosmopolitan urban center, it grew unattached to its own dismantled institution of domestic slavery, less and less united on the broader issue of slavery in the Union, and consequently less and less culturally bonded to its slave-owning trading partners in the South. While the commitment to slavery grew ever stronger in most slave states through the first half of the 19th century, it grew progressively weaker in Gotham. Statistics illustrate this point. In 1790, blacks made up 2,500 of the city's 60,000 residents, a relatively small but quite visible minority in a town where one of every 17 artisans was still a slave owner. By 1800, the black population had increased modestly to 3,500, but within one decade, free black New Yorkers had come to outnumber slaves. At the dawning of a new century, and even before the massive influx of Southern cotton would weld New York's economy to the South, support for slavery had become, in the words of Edwin Burroughs, thinner and more fragile than at any time in the previous century. In 1799, the state passed legislation ensuring gradual emancipation, an initiative that brought an unexpectedly rapid decline in slave owning in both state and city. By 1810, 84% of the state's 9,000 blacks were free, compared to 33% in 1790. New York's gradual disentanglement from the institution of slavery would continue as the 19th century progressed. By July 4, 1827, the city's slave system was gone. The withering of demand for slave labor had been encouraged by the ever-increasing supply of cheap labor furnished by immigrants pouring into the metropolis from Europe. Though the free black population of New York continued to increase briskly, growing from 2,500 in 1790 to 14,000 in 1830, Gotham's total population increased even more dramatically. As a result of this explosive population growth, blacks declined as a percentage of the population, falling from 9 to 7% during the single decade of the 1820s. Southerners who visited New York City during the antebellum decades could not have been unaware of the demographic and cultural changes that were making Gotham less and less comfortable with the idea of chattel slavery. New Yorkers continued to vie successfully for Southern cotton and to welcome Southern visitors with open arms, but they would increasingly view the peculiar institution upon which their Southern friends and clients had established their wealth as an unpleasant anachronism. In August of 1831, at about the time Southerners were beginning to question the wisdom of allowing New York to control their region's trade and banking, Nat Turner led a bloody and shocking slave rebellion in Virginia that brutally shattered the South's carefully cultivated myth of benevolent and paternal planter aristocrats lording over placid and contented Negro slaves. Turner's insurrection resulted in what historians have described as the last lengthy and free discussion of slavery south of the Mason-Dixon line. The debate took place in Richmond in the Virginia legislature during January of 1832. It resulted in the decisive defeat of the state's anti-slavery forces. For all practical purposes, the slave question was closed in the Old Dominion. And as Virginia went, so went all the slaveholding South. With the continued profitability of slavery, especially in the Cotton Belt, and with mounting attacks on the institution from increasingly emboldened abolitionists, the South hunkered down in a defensive intellectual posture, one that grew more belligerent and defiant as the Union moved ever closer to the Civil War. For white Southerners, the survival of the plantation system seemed to demand absolute racial and ideological unity. The departure of any Southerner from the tenets of pro-slave orthodoxy represented a kind of treason, a betrayal of one's race, and an assault on the very foundations of Southern society. The defense of slavery would lead tragically to the region's savage intolerance of anti-slave opinion and to what Fred Hobson has characterized as the closing of the Southern mind. By the politically contentious and increasingly tense 1850s, the beleaguered slaveholders of the South looked toward New York City with increased impatience and urgency. Here was a place that for decades had waxed fat off the products of Southern slavery, and that had welcomed Southerners to come and spend their fortunes in its hotels, restaurants, and emporiums. It was time for Gotham to rise with one voice and come to the defense of the South and of slavery. And what sort of resistance to abolitionist attacks on their peculiar institution did the region expect from the merchants and bankers who they assumed ruled Manhattan? To have some idea of the response that the slave states demanded from pro-Southern New Yorkers, it would be instructive to look at how they themselves had dealt with those fellow Southerners who had dared publicly to criticize or question slavery. Precious few had chosen since 1832 to question the South's racial orthodoxy. But of these few, the most interesting of the region's antebellum iconoclasts was North Carolina native Hinton Rowan Helper. Hinton Helper would have seemed an ideal candidate for critiquing and questioning Southern slavery. Born and bred in North Carolina, he was no friend of the black race, and he was not much interested in examining the ethical or moral dimensions of the institution. His overriding concern, expressed vigorously in The Impending Crisis of the South, was with the calamitous effects of the slave labor system on the economic well-being of the white middle and working classes. He argued that slavery and nothing but slavery had retarded the progress and prosperity of our portion of the Union, depopulated and impoverished our cities by forcing the more industrious and enterprising natives of the soil to emigrate to the free states, brought our domain under a sparse and inert population by preventing foreign immigration, made us tributary to the North and reduced us to the humiliating condition of mere provincial subjects in fact, though not in name. Helper was convinced that only by destroying chattel slavery could the 6 millions of non-slaveholding whites liberate themselves from what he described as a second degree of slavery. And by whom were these nominally free Southern yeomen enslaved? They were in bondage to the great planters and their commercial allies who had achieved complete domination over the South's political system. Even though non-slaveholders outnumbered slaveholders by 6 to 1, he argued, this massive majority had never yet had any uncontrolled part or lot in framing the laws under which they lived. Consequently, there was in the Southern states no legislation except for the benefit of slavery and slaveholders. The planter elite had created a cunningly devised mockery of freedom, extending to middling Southern farmers, laborers, and craftsmen a dubious privilege, a shallow and circumscribed participation in the political movements that usher slaveholders into office. In The Impending Crisis of the South, Hinton Helper appealed to the mass of fellow white Southerners to divorce themselves from the siren call of white racial unity, to see that their economic and social interests would never be furthered by binding themselves loyally to the great planters. Non-slaveholders needed to recognize that slaveholders were arrogant demagogues whom you have elected to offices of honor and profit, men who had hoodwinked you, trifled with you, and used you as mere tools for the consummation of their wicked designs. Only when middling Southerners understood their true relation to the institution of slavery could they liberate themselves from their own servitude and elect leaders who would level the playing field for white laborers by heavily taxing slave owners and using the revenue to finance the shipment of inferior blacks back to Africa. When he published his appeal in 1857, Helper obviously entertained the hope that thoughtful fellow Southerners, true-hearted, candid, and intelligent men, would read his book. Indeed, he allowed himself to imagine that these Southern readers might be legion. In fact, though many people in the South knew about his book, only a very small number read it, and nearly all these readers seemed to have found The Impending Crisis to be both a hideous and an extremely dangerous text. Indeed, Robert Downs has caustically observed that it was nearly impossible to obtain a copy of Helper's work in any part of the South. Many legislatures passed laws forbidding its possession or sale. Men were hanged for possessing copies. Mobs in Helper's native North Carolina drove several ministers out of the state for defending the book, and there was a public book burning in one town. In other slave states, men were mobbed and beaten for having Helper's work in their homes. Those select Southern critics who reviewed Impending Crisis made clear why it was a poisonous work not safe to be placed in the hands of readers. It was a deadly attack upon their peculiar institution. It was also incendiary, insurrectionary, and hostile to the peace and domestic tranquility of the country. Helper himself was the lowest type of man, a despised traitor to his native sod and native skies. Of humanity's miserable renegades and mendacious miscreants, he was surely among the worst. Though idealistically Helper may have hoped for a receptive and large Southern audience, practically, he seems to have known better than to trust his region's capacity for intelligence and clear thinking on the issue of slavery. By the time his book was published, he had conveniently located himself north of the Mason-Dixon in New York City. He had initially intended to publish his work in Baltimore, but slaveholding Maryland forbade the publication of any writing intended to excite discontent amongst the people of color of this state. Gotham would prove a less hostile milieu for Helper. Pro-Southern journalists like James Gordon Bennett warned that his book contained gunpowder enough to blow the Union to the devil. But prominent abolitionist editor Horace Greeley praised The Impending Crisis and prompted the Republican Party to print and distribute 100,000 copies of an abridged edition during the 1860 presidential campaign. Thanks to his move to New York City, he would find a wide audience and become as celebrated north of the Mason-Dixon as he was reviled in his native South. Though undoubtedly disappointed by having failed to connect with a Southern audience, he could not have been altogether surprised. For in the impending crisis, he had brilliantly identified the homogeneity and conformity of the South's thinking about the issue of slavery and the monolithic solidity of his region's slave culture. He had diagnosed the stultification of the entire mind of the South that was the terrible result of its acquiescence with slavery, and he fully understood the disastrous consequences of this blind acquiescence for open inquiry and intellectual diversity. Free speech is an institution almost unknown at the South. Free speech is considered as treason against slavery, and when people dare neither speak nor print their thoughts, free thought itself is well nigh extinguished. All that can be said in defense of human bondage may be spoken freely, but question either its morality or its policy, and the terrors of lynch law are at once invoked to put down the pestilent heresy. It is extraordinarily ironic that in this passage, Hinton Helper anticipated with uncanny accuracy the hysterical response with which his fellow Southerners would greet the impending crisis of the South. He would pay the price for frankly and fearlessly articulating what 20th century critics of Southern culture would come to understand decades hence: the inconvenient truth that not only had slavery affected Southern prosperity, it had also closed the Southern mind. As we will hear in the following chapters, the love-hate affair between New York City and the plantation South that had begun so hopefully for both parties by 1820 was fated to end badly. True, despite initial Southern apprehension about Gotham's economic and cultural hegemony, the entente between the two parties had been relatively easy to maintain in the 1820s and 1830s. But as abolitionist sentiment grew stronger in the 1840s and 1850s, and as New York rapidly transformed itself into a more cosmopolitan and complexly structured urban center, interregional relations inevitably grew more and more fraught. While slavery led the Southern mind to close and retreat from the world, witness the reception to Hinton Helper's book, enormous prosperity brought on by the cotton trade expanded both New York City's challenges and problems and its civic ambitions and cultural horizons. By the 1850s, Southern defenders of slavery were insistently calling on Gotham to support their cause by behaving politically more like a provincial Southern city. The very thing that New York was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.